Lady Monckton, the news of the Duchess of Windsor's death must be very sad for you as one of her good friends. What kind of a gap do you think it's going to leave in your life?
I think it will leave a great gap, because though I haven't seen her a great deal latterly, owing to her illness, I used to see her a great deal both when the Duke was alive and then afterwards. I was one of her few remaining friends, so certainly one of her only English friends, and I used to go over and visit her in Paris about once a month, the weekend once a month. So I shall miss her very much. I've been missing her quite a lot while she's been ill. And they were most welcoming, and they asked us to go over, both to stay with her in Paris and also when they bought the mill. And then we were always going over if the Duke was in any difficulties or troubles or any possible misunderstandings on this side of the channel. We used to go over to try and sort of for my husband to sort it out for him.
To describe her as accurately as you can to people like us who never knew her, what quality was it about her that you particularly liked?
Well, she was always gay. She was always ready to do anything or try anything. The only thing she couldn't try, or she did try, but she hated it so much, was flying. That was a nightmare to her. The only time I flew with her and the Duke, we flew down to Marbella in Spain, and she had to have sleeping pills or something of that kind because she couldn't bear it, and she covered her eyes with a sort of black mask. And it was a great difficulty in getting her there, but it would have taken 2 days to have got there by road or by train. So she did put up with it.
Unwillingly. Yes. The love affair and the marriage of the Duke and Duchess of Windsor provided one of the fairy tale stories of the century. Was it like that, really?
Oh, yes. He absolutely adored and worshipped her. He would get himself in a great state if she was late coming back from Paris. He was sitting in the waiting, having his tea after a game of golf, and he kept saying, "What can have happened to the Duchess? She's so late." So I said, "Well, you know, if you go to a hairdresser, you've got to expect to be kept waiting, or it'll take longer than expected. The same thing if you go and try on clothes at Dior. They're not very fast in their procedure." But he was in a terrible tizzy, really, until she arrived, and then he greeted her as if she'd been away for a couple of months almost.
Did he tick her off when she finally did come home?
No, I mean not the least. He just said, "Darling, what have you been doing? Why are you so late?" And she'd explain that it was the hairdresser or the dressmaker, or that she'd been to a museum or something like that. Though latterly she didn't go much to museums or antiquaires. Because they had everything.
She had beautiful taste, didn't she?
Oh, she had marvellous taste. Not only taste in her clothes, which are always absolutely perfect, but in the houses. They were so well arranged, everything was thought out. Every conceivable thing for one's comfort of the guests was considered. And then she took immense trouble about the food that you ate. If somebody, she like me, I'm always on a diet, so always this great care was taken that I didn't have anything that would disagree with me. And she knew a lot about wine as well. In fact, I think she bought all the wine and not the Duke. She was very nice to all her friends, young children, young people.
Do you think that the Duke ever regretted the fact that he'd abdicated and given up the throne for her?
No, I don't think so. I think he worshipped the ground she trod on, and I don't think he ever regretted it for a moment. I mean, he would complain about British politics and British politicians and things like that, but then we all do that. There's nothing really new about that or different.
Lady Monckton, thank you very much indeed.